mad, sad, and impossible to know when he would fling himself into a violent rage or burst into song. That's the image of George III that has lasted, the king who went mad. But those final years of insanity were, in fact, the tragic end to a reign which, in the face of enormous upheavals, had been one of the most popular in British history.
This was a king who cared passionately about Britain. He was a king who believed that monarchs were born to rule, not simply turn out for parades. Yet he was also the king who lost it all. He lost his power to control Parliament, he lost his power to control his colonies, and in the end, he lost the power to control his own mind.
In 1760, a royal messenger bringing news from Kensington Palace that George II was dying. Prince George, his grandson, was out riding near his favourite palace at Kew when the messenger arrived. The news that he was about to become the king was a shock for the 22-year-old, but the people welcomed him like a breath of fresh air. George III was intelligent, tall and spirited. He was inheriting a kingdom in good shape. Everything boded well.
He was the first king in decades to be born and raised in Britain. His predecessors, George I and George II, had been very much Hanoverian Germans. They'd been brought over to stabilise the monarchy after it had become so unpopular in the 17th century. But being foreigners, they'd never been really accepted. George I didn't even speak English. George III planned to do things very differently.
The man who, above all others, shaped his ideas was his tutor, the Earl of Bute. John Stuart Bute had been a Lord of the Bedchamber to George's father, Prince Frederick, though Frederick had held a pretty low opinion of him. Bute would make an excellent ambassador, he said, in some proud little court where there is nothing to do. When Frederick died, Bute soon slipped into the role of tutor and father figure to the young prince, who became devoted to him. Bute was a reliable friend. He offered George good advice about marriage, steering him towards the young German princess Charlotte, whom George married in September 1761. But Bute also planted the idea that George was living in a wicked age when men would stop at nothing to attack the crown. Previous Hanoverian kings had surrendered considerable power to the dominant Whig party and its forceful ministers. Whilst he accepted the superiority of Parliament, George felt that he should have a prime minister whose support he could count on. In May 1762, without reference to Parliament, he gave Bute the job.
It was a disastrous decision made by a young and inexperienced king, for Bute essentially was a behind-the-scenes operator with virtually no political experience. He made a hopeless prime minister. He could never command the respect of the heavyweight parliamentarians, Lord Newcastle, William Pitt. They thought him pompous and a political coward.
Outside Parliament, Bute was a figure of fun, partly because he was known to be having an affair with George's mother.
Go on, big on.
After less than a year in office, he was desperate to resign. If I had but £50 per annum, he wrote, I would retire on bread and water and think it luxury compared with what I suffer.
The king felt let down. Having no faith in politicians, there was no one he could turn to. He could only achieve his ambitions for the monarchy through his ministers. and yet he seemed unable to find a prime minister he could get on with and who in turn would dominate Parliament. The result was a bad press. Despite their best efforts, the King and his advisers became the targets for some merciless mockery from journalists.
And one journalist stood above the rest. John Wilkes. That devil Wilkes, as George called him, was an MP as well as editor of the Republican newspaper, The North Briton. In 1763, there was a scandal. Edition number 45 openly criticised George, suggesting he was a liar. The government issued a general warrant for the arrest of anyone involved in its publication. Wilkes was charged and sent to the Tower. From there, he complained that as a member of Parliament, he could not be imprisoned for speaking his mind. At the time, Britain considered itself one of the more liberal, enlightened countries of Europe. A howl of public protest went up. The right to free speech was being threatened. And then, as Parliament debated the issue, Wilkes was released. The King was horrified. No man was more threatening to his idea of kingship than Wilkes. He had to be stopped. With trouble brewing, Wilkes fled to France. And George gained a few years' peace. He might still be wrangling with his ministers, and there were protests in America against British taxes, but at least he was spared the jibes of John Wilkes.